In the last video, we looked at linear spaces, which are an abstract way of thinking about vectors. In this video, I want to look at the dimension of a linear space and how the concept of dimension is much more general than one might think. This video is a part of From Zero to Geo, a series where we formulate geometric algebra, an incredibly powerful branch of mathematics, from the ground up. To start our discussion on dimension, I want to point out a pattern that you might have noticed. Given a one-dimensional space, we can describe any vector in it using a basis that contains a single vector. In a two-dimensional space, we can describe any vector in it using a basis that contains two vectors. In a three-dimensional space, we can describe any vector in it using a basis that contains three vectors. Thus, we describe a one-dimensional space with a basis containing one vector, a two-dimensional space with a basis containing two vectors, and a three-dimensional space with a basis containing three vectors. Wait a minute! The size of the basis is the same as the dimension of the space! Now the question is this always true? It may seem obvious that this is true for the standard basis, but what about other bases? Try to answer this yourself! While it's a little difficult to prove rigorously, try to come up with the best argument you can. Because rigorous proofs of this fact can be annoying, I'll provide a non-rigorous argument here. Let's start with considering one-dimensional spaces. We can't get anywhere with no vectors, so a basis for this space needs at least one vector. Now, by scaling this vector, we can reach any of the vectors in the space, so this one vector is a basis for this space. Adding any other vector in the space to this set won't change the span, so any sets with two or more vectors are linearly dependent, meaning they are not a basis. Thus, every basis in one-dimensional space contains only one vector. Conversely, if we have a basis with one element, its span is all scalar multiples of it, which is a one-dimensional space. Thus, a space is one-dimensional if and only if it has a basis of size 1. Now for two-dimensional space, we can do something similar. From the one-dimensional argument, we know that the span of one vector will never be a two-dimensional space, so we need at least two vectors. The first of these two vectors will always span a one-dimensional subspace, and because the vectors are linearly independent, the second vector must not lie on this line. Thus, the span of the two vectors will be the whole plane, meaning that they are a basis for the plane. Adding any other vector to this set won't change the span, so any sets with three or more vectors are linearly dependent, meaning they are not a basis. Thus, every basis in two-dimensional space contains exactly two vectors. Conversely, if we have a basis with two elements, we can't use a linear combination to leave the plane the two vectors make, so their span is this plane, which is a two-dimensional space. Thus, a space is two-dimensional if and only if it has a basis of size 2. Again, for three-dimensional space, we can do something similar. From the previous arguments, we know that the span of one or two vectors will never be a three-dimensional space, so we need at least three vectors. One of these vectors will span a one-dimensional subspace, and because the vectors are linearly independent, the other two vectors must not lie on this line. Thus, the span of two of the vectors will be a plane. Again, because the vectors are linearly independent, the last vector must not lie on this plane. Thus, the span of the three vectors will be all of space. Adding any other vector to this set won't change the span, so any sets with four or more vectors are linearly dependent, meaning they are not a basis. Thus, every basis in three-dimensional space contains exactly three vectors. Conversely, if we have a basis with three elements, we can't use a linear combination to leave the space the three vectors make, so their span is three-dimensional space. Thus, a space is three-dimensional if and only if it has a basis of size 3. Hopefully you can see how this argument generalizes to show that yes, the size of a basis is equal to the dimension of a space. But wait, what actually is the dimension of a space? While it might feel obvious when working with arrows, we've seen previously that mathematicians like to define vectors as abstract objects satisfying a bunch of conditions. So what is the dimension of a linear space that's more abstract? Well, since in the linear space of arrows, the dimension of a space is the same as the size of a basis for the space, why don't we use this as the definition of the dimension of any linear space? To be more precise, we'll define the dimension of a linear space to simply be the size of a basis for that space. Thus, we will say that any abstract linear space with a basis of size 2 is two-dimensional, that any linear space with a basis of size 3 is three-dimensional, etc. This idea is one of mathematicians' primary ways of doing math in higher-dimensional space. Even if we can't truly visualize higher-dimensional space, we can still just pick, say, four symbols that we will consider to be a basis for some linear space. Because this basis has a size of 4, this linear space is four-dimensional. If we assume that this basis represents arrows in four-dimensional space just like we do for lower-dimensional spaces, we can start doing four-dimensional geometry without the need for visualization. Now you might be wondering why we should care about higher-dimensional space in the first place. While I personally think that studying higher-dimensional space for its own sake is enough, there are other reasons. For us, it will be important for two reasons. First, there are many ways that we can do geometry by considering a linear space with a higher dimension. For example, in PGA, we do three-dimensional geometry by using a four-dimensional space. Second, some features of geometric algebra don't show up until we explore higher-dimensional geometric algebra. One important feature doesn't show up until four dimensions, and there are even some things that don't show up until six dimensions. Thus, if we really want to explore and understand geometric algebra, we're going to have to use higher dimensional space. Now, the issue with this is that it's impossible to truly visualize higher dimensional space. Some people try to get around this by using various techniques, which produce pictures like this for a 4D cube, but none of these techniques enable us to truly visualize 4D space. Saying that this image is a 4D cube is like saying that this image is a 3D cube. Now it is true that with a change in perspective, you can see how this is a cube, but it's still just a 2D image that we have trained ourselves to understand as a 3D object. While you can do this change in perspective for the 4D cube as well, and it makes for a pretty animation, it still isn't actually helping you to truly visualize 4D space. At best, it just looks like a funky, morphing 3D object. Because of these issues, if I ever have to talk about higher dimensional space in the future, I will usually not do any visualization. Thankfully, the times that we have to think about higher dimensional space in this way are few. With all of that out of the way, let's do an exercise. Go back to the last video about linear spaces and find the dimension of all of the examples there. For reference, here are all of the linear spaces that were presented in that video. Actually, we've been talking about the dimension of the linear space of arrows throughout this whole video, so let's skip that one. Now, some of these examples actually cover multiple spaces of different dimension, so in those cases, try to figure out what dimension each individual space has. Please pause the video and do this before continuing. So first up is the linear space of numbers. Recall that we make numbers into a linear space by just using normal addition and multiplication. So what's a basis for this linear space? Well, notice that every number can be written as that number times 1. It might be hard to recognize in this form, but this is actually a linear combination. It's just a sum with one term, a times 1. We can see 1 as being the vector and a as being the scalar. Thus, we see that the set containing just 1 is a spanning set for the space of numbers. Furthermore, because this set contains just one non-zero vector, it is linearly independent, so it is a basis for the linear space of numbers. Because this basis has a size of 1, numbers are a one-dimensional space. The next example is lists of numbers. What is a basis for this linear space? There are two ways to figure this out. First, we can remember that we got the whole idea for lists of numbers from arrows. When we represent an arrow in terms of a basis, we can think of the coefficients as being a list of numbers. Then, we can just take our basis in the linear space of arrows, convert them to lists of numbers, and that should be a basis for the linear space of lists of numbers. A second argument for this basis is that since 1 is the basis for the linear space of numbers, and lists of numbers are just, well, lists of numbers, we can make a basis by putting the basis for numbers in every place a number can be. Whatever way you try to do it, these vectors do, in fact, form a basis for the linear space of lists of numbers. Now, because this basis has a size of 2, does that mean that the dimension of this linear space is 2? The issue with this is that if we do the same argument with lists of 3 numbers, we get 3 basis vectors, so lists of numbers with 3 entries are 3-dimensional. So we see that this is one of those cases where we have multiple linear spaces that have different dimension. It shouldn't be too hard to convince yourself that lists with n entries are n-dimensional. Now, the next example from the previous video is 2-dimensional lines. You might think that this space is 2-dimensional because of the name, but math throws us a curveball here. In this linear space, we represent lines using equations in this form. Looking at this equation, it looks like a linear combination with 3 terms, not 2. In fact, in my video focusing on this linear space, we saw that we can find 3 vectors that act as a basis for this linear space under this correspondence. Thus, despite the name, the linear space of 2-dimensional lines is actually a 3-dimensional space. Now, the last example of a linear space in the previous video was functions. Recall that we define addition and scalar multiplication by adding and scaling the results of functions. To find the dimension of this space, we need to find a basis for it. So, what is a basis for this space? This is actually surprisingly tough to figure out, so I'll just state the result here. We can prove that there does exist a basis, but it's impossible to fully describe it. We can at least prove that any basis for this space is infinite, meaning that this linear space is actually infinite dimensional. While a basis for all functions might be impossible to describe, for certain subspaces it is much easier. For example, I mentioned in the previous video that the set containing all powers of x is a basis for the linear space of polynomials. Despite polynomials being a small subspace of the linear space of functions, we see that a basis for them is still infinite, so polynomials are also an infinite dimensional space. Now, if all of this talk about function spaces and infinite dimensional spaces is confusing, don't worry. In this series, we won't really ever have the need to talk about infinite dimensional spaces, and up until Chapter 7, we will always assume that we are working in finite dimensional spaces. However, there is one important point that I want to make through all of these examples. Oftentimes, the definition of dimension I gave in this video doesn't really match what we geometrically think of as dimension. I mean, come on! 2-dimensional lines are 3-dimensional? That's just ridiculous! We'll also see in the next chapter that there's a way in which numbers are 0-dimensional, not 1-dimensional, and to be frank, the whole idea of infinite dimensional spaces just sounds preposterous. This overloading of the term dimension is even worse in geometric algebra. There is a sense in which the statement, 1D objects in 3D space can be described as the 6D subspace of 2D elements in the 16D algebra created by the 4D space of 2D objects in 3D space, is true. Now, of course, I cherry-picked this example and worded it this way because of how ridiculous it sounds, but it still showcases an unfortunate problem. The word dimension is used for too many things. In a sense, the word itself is multidimensional. Because of this, I will often try to use words other than dimension for many of these concepts. Thus, in the future, to describe the concept I introduced in this video, I'll say things like algebraic dimension or number of components. In the future, if I use the word dimension on its own, I will be using it in the colloquial geometric sense to refer to how many directions you can go in geometric space. Now, despite going on for a while about the terminology, algebraic dimension is still a good concept to know about for the reasons I stated earlier in the video. Many of the quirks in geometric algebra depend on the algebraic dimension, not the geometric dimension. Whenever we encounter a linear space in the future, we will often try to figure out what algebraic dimension it has. At this point, you might wonder what else there is to study about vectors. However, remember that we still haven't defined a couple of operations, namely, multiplying vectors with each other and adding scalars and vectors. While multiplying vectors will have to wait until Chapter 3, we will finally learn how to add scalars and vectors in the next video.